an extreme pleasure that DIIPA decided to host the C.V. Raman Memorial Lecture at IOP this year. As you know, the Indian Physics Association has many memorial awards, and this year the C.V. Raman Memorial Award went to Professor Ashok Das, who is our adjunct faculty member, or otherwise son of the soil of Odisha, and he has been working from 1982 in University of Rochester, USA. Professor Das is a well-known face, at least most of the audience here. And however, since there are students which are visiting students from this institute in the summer and might be from other institutes, it would be nice actually to welcome Professor Das to give this lecture with a bouquet of flower, and he will look towards the audience so that people know who is Professor Ashok Das. Again, for formality's sake, let me tell few things about him. Professor Das was born in March in 1953, and in fact, it was the last week he showed me where he was born. He was born in Puri, and the house where he was born is now renovated, and I read the house that it is some excise department's holiday home. And Professor Das stood first in his batch in matriculation in Odisha. In matriculation at that time is to up to class 11th. And then he went for Delhi University to do his BS, and which was in 72. In 74 he did his MS from Delhi University, and in 77 he did his PhD from Stony Brook, USA. Note here, 74 MS and 77 PhD. At least he didn't have to struggle for 6th year, 7th year fellowship in USA, unlike what we are struggling from the funding agency to fund in today's world. Or maybe at that time it was easy, I don't know. Professor Das might tell that privately to us. His thesis was spin 3x2 fields and supergravity theories. So this is the work which was happening in 75-76. Supersymmetry and supergravity both are new, and he was doing his PhD, and his contribution was really excellent. Even it has gone, there are potential in his name called Das potential, which sometimes in 93-94 I studied in my work, and I realized that I wanted to know who is this Das, and it turned out this Das I knew. There are several awards he has got, and among them I will mention few. I just mentioned that he stood first in the matriculation examination conducted by in Odisha, but he also occupied the second positions both in what is known as at the time PU, pre-university examination in Odisha. And privately I know that he was not happy, and he wanted not to do any more studies in Odisha and went to Delhi. I also know when he reached Delhi, what, from the railway station, how he went to the Delhi University, but that I will tell in some other time, whoever is interested to know. And in Delhi, both in BSc and MSc, he stood second. And after that, he went to Stony Brook for his PhD. And after 77, after finishing PhD, he did his postdocs, and the postdocs are in City College Newark from 77 to 79, then in University of Maryland from 79 to 81, then in Rutgers University from 81 to 82, and finally joined as a faculty member in University of Rochester and from in 82 and till now he is there. He also became adjunct faculty in 2005 in SIMB and here in IOP in 2015. Professor Das has written around 260 papers, 19 books and 5 books edited by him. Anyone who has followed any of his books, which are basically written at the output of his lecture notes, whatever he has taught, can understand that how much he effort he has put to write in the books. Specifically, the books are very good for teachers in the sense, unlike many other textbooks where you have to spend time to derive from one step to the other, these books are, everything is derived there. So you don't have, one doesn't have to take that, put that effort also to derive from step to step. And among other awards, several times actually, he has got the award of excellence in undergraduate teaching in 87, then in 90, then Edward Peck Kutis Award for Excellence in Undergraduate Teaching in 91, again Undergraduate Teaching Excellence in 97, 2005, then William Riker University Award for Excellence in Graduate Teaching in 2005, Outstanding Junior Investigator from 83 to 89, Fulbright Fellowship from 97 to 98. He is a Fellow of American Physical Society. He also received Rockefeller Foundation Award in 2004 and again Fulbright Fellowship from 2006 to 2007. This is about the academic thing. But anyone who has talked to him also finds the human side of him. A great man to have nearby and talk when you are depressed. I am very lucky that for many years I know him, I have collaborated with him. Much more than that is, just his words are so much valuable for me in my depression period, which has helped me to come out of my depression and go ahead in life. I am also extremely lucky that he accepted our offer of being adjunct faculty in the institute. 2 years ago when he came, he gave a series of lectures in final temperature field theory. Last year also there are some lectures. And today, he will be giving us his award-winning lecture called The Emerging Integrable Models. Let's hear from him. Welcome, Professor Das.
Models and hopefully you will get interested in the field. out by saying that there are several, not many, but several different nonlinear differential or partial differential equations which can be exactly solved. Okay, these are nonlinear, but they can be exactly solved. And generally, those are called integrable models, okay, the nonlinear ones. And there are many, many examples. So in lattice models, zero space and one time dimensions, there are the Toda lattice, there are the spin chains, and several others. If you go to one space and one time dimensions, so two dimensions, then there are actually a whole lot of models. The most common among them is the KdV or the Courtois de Vries equation. I will be talking about that a lot. You have nonlinear Schrodinger equation, Sine-Gordon equation, Liouville equation, several of them. But as you go beyond two dimensions, 1+1 to say two space and one dimensions, then the number of models reduce. And in fact, we have only two equations. Kp is the Kadomozev-Petriasvili equation, and the Davies-Stewartson model, only two. And those two, again, are not genuine three-dimensional integrable models. Rather, they have an embedded two-dimensional structure there. And then we don't know, so far, we don't know any four-dimensional integrable models. And there are reasons for that, but I will not go into that because this is a general talk. And these kinds of systems, as I said, show up in almost all branches of physics. They started out with hydrodynamics. They show up in plasma physics. They show up in biophysics, medical physics, optics, all kind of astrophysics, high energy physics. So in almost all branches of physics, you find these things, even medical, even in defense studies. And so what I wanted to describe to you is that these are very special models, not like the ones that you are taught in classes. And so I wanted to describe to you some of the beautiful features of these models. And there are many. I cannot cover all of them, but at least some of them that stand out. So what's the history of these models? Well, you know that if you look at a normal water wave, when you throw a stone, a water wave starts in the pond, and then very quickly it disperses, it really dies down, right? So that's the normal water wave. But in 1834, there was a 26-year-old engineer, Scottish engineer, who noticed something remarkable. He realized that there was a wave, he saw a wave, just a solitary wave, a single wave, and it actually was moving, traveling, without changing its shape, and he became curious, and he actually followed it on the horse, and it went for miles without changing its shape at all. Okay? And so what he did is that he reported that observation to the Royal Society, and that was the first recorded report on this kind of a phenomenon. I'm sure there are probably other people who observed, but this is when it got reported in 1834. And then people became interested, and Courtois and de Vries, they studied this phenomena. And in 1895, so that's more than 60 years later, that they proposed an equation to describe these kinds of water waves, shallow water waves. And that equation is known as the KdV equation. And it took so long, 60 years. Why? Because they first had to do an experiment in the lab to produce these kinds of waves, and then study its properties, and then give an equation which will describe its features. Well, I will show to you what the KdV equation is, but it's a nonlinear equation. And so it's very hard to solve. And so nothing was known about the KdV equation. The equation was there, but nothing was known about the solutions till about 1965. So that's another 70 years. So for another 70 years, there was an equation, but we didn't know how to solve it. We didn't know what are the characteristics of this, what are the properties of this equation or the solutions. What happened in 1965? Well, the Second World War was over, and the computers became available to scientists. And so people, for the first time, started doing numerical calculations. And one of the very important numerical calculations was by Fermi, Pasteur, and Ulam. And they studied the enharmonic interactions of phonons on the lattice numerically using computers. Okay, so that was the first remarkable numerical study. And so, inspired by Fermi, Pasteur, and Ulam, Kruskal and Zabuski, who were very good mathematical physicists, they actually decided that they would study the KdV equation numerically. You cannot solve it, at least one didn't know how to solve it at that time. So they decided that they will actually study numerically. And what they found was simply remarkable. And what they found is that if you let two localized solutions of this equation move towards each other, collide with each other, actually what happens is that you let one move this way and the other move that way, so they collide. And where they collide, there is actually a lot of mess. But when they separate, when they move out, they actually move out like nothing had happened. They maintain their shape, even through collisions. Okay? So this was really fantastic, because what this is saying is that these solutions, which are because of the nonlinear interactions, where there are nonlinear interactions, very strong, they actually behave like there is no interaction at all. They collide and they just go through completely transparently. And that led to a lot of interest in the KdV equation. And in 1969, Kruskal coined the name for such solutions to be soliton solutions, solitons. And he defined the solitons as traveling wave solutions that are localized, that are non-dispersive, and that those maintain their shape even after collisions. So there were three conditions. He said they have to be, they are traveling solutions, they have to be localized, so think of a bell-shaped curve, a localized, like I drew, a localized solution that does not disperse, so it doesn't spread out, and then even if you collide them, they actually don't change their shape. So there was a lot of interest in the KdV equation right after that, but soon people...
In this moment, whether the particle actually moves or the wave on
which part? So the wave moves as a whole. That thing is called the soliton, that entire structure. This is a localized structure, right? So it only extends up to a finite region, and that thing is called the soliton. It's not a particle.
Not a particle.
Okay? So soon after this soliton scattering happened, then people found that actually this is not a particular property of KdV equation. It is a common property of a whole class of models, which I have defined for you as the integrable models. Okay? So this is the brief history of this subject. And so let me now tell you what is the KdV equation. Okay? So this is the introduction to KdV. The properties are common to many systems, But I will describe the properties only in the example of KDB because they are the same in all models.
But that part is not clear to me. When we are talking about that it is localized, so that means
particle. Why did you think of particle?
It's a classical fluid, it's not quantum.
Yeah, it's a classical solution.
Classical fluid.
Yeah. Right? So it's a solution, it's a wave. Remember the Scottish engineer, he saw a water wave moving for miles without changing its shape. So that's how I'm talking about. All of those came after what? The pulse came after 1965. Okay? So I will tell you why these solutions are of interest in a little while. But let me go step by step. So the KdV equation, right? So that's the only example I will be talking about. But the features, the properties would apply to all integrable systems. So here, the equation is a 1 plus 1 dimensional equation, one space and one time. So u is a variable, dynamical variable, which depends on x and t. X is the space coordinate and t is the time. And the time evolution of u is given by these two terms on the right hand side. So here, u, the variable, you can think of as the height of the water wave from the normal surface, okay? And that depends on where it is at coordinate x and t, and the time evolution of that variable is given by two terms. One is nonlinear, u times ux is quadratic in u, and one is linear, u, simply u, but has higher derivatives. Okay, so there are two terms that contribute to the time evolution of this KdV variable. And what I will show you, by the way, before I go on, these two terms I can also write as a total derivative, and so that you can think of the KdV equation as a continuity equation. I will use this fact later, so that I'm pointing out now. The time derivative of u is the space derivative of something, so that's like a continuity equation. So now there are two terms that contribute to the time evolution of the KdV variable. One is linear, one is nonlinear, and I will show to you now that the linear term leads to dispersion of the wave, whereas the nonlinear term is the one that has the localizing effect, and therefore there is a possibility that there can be non-dispersive solution. So how do we see? Well, suppose you forget about the nonlinear term. We just look at the linear equation that ut is u triple x. Well, then almost all linear equations are dispersive. We know except for photon, every other linear equation is dispersive. Here too, you can immediately see from this that the dispersion relation would be energy equal to k cubed, the momentum cubed. Okay? And therefore, you immediately see that associated with a motion, there is a phase velocity, which is of course energy over k, that's k squared. But there is also, if you have a wave packet, if you have a localized solution, then there is a group velocity also, which is given by the derivative, which is 3 times k squared. So you have a phase velocity, which is different from the group velocity. So if you have a localized solution, a wave packet kind of a solution, well, then the components should move at a speed different from the packet itself or the wave itself, and so they will disperse. Okay? So this is standard. This is in you know from free particle solution in quantum mechanics that linear equations are by and large dispersive. They spread out with time. What happens if I ignore the linear term and look at the nonlinear term only? Well, you can do that. So the equation would become ut is u times ux. That's a nonlinear term on the right hand side. And that equation is quite famous. It's known as the Riemann equation. Okay? And it explains many phenomena. I'll point out one in a minute. And this equation you can solve very easily, and normally this is solved by using what is known as the method of characteristics. So you go to the characteristics curve where the solution is actually a constant, and if you do that, then using the method of characteristics, the solution can be written as a function of x plus u times t. U is a constant actually on the characteristics. So this is a traveling wave solution, x plus something, function of x plus something, it's moving. But what is amazing here is that it is moving with a speed u. But I told you that u is the height of the wave above the normal surface. So the speed with which this wave moves is proportional to the height of the wave. And that's very interesting. That says that the higher the wave, the faster it moves. So suppose you have a wave like so, then that would say that the top point is higher, so it would move faster. And then the bottom part would actually is lower, so it would move slower. So this part would be moving faster, this part not so fast. So there is a squeezing kind of effect, there is a localizing effect. And in fact, this leads to phenomena like breaking of waves that you see in the seabed, right? Because after a while, this would go like this wave would go like so. And then it would go like, and would break. So this is what you see when you are in a sea beach, and that's called the breaking of waves, and that's explained by the Riemann equation. So there are two terms in the KdV equation. One is linear, that leads to dispersion of the wave, and one is nonlinear, that leads to localizing. So if the nonlinearity and the derivative, the dispersion, have the right behavior, you can actually have a solution which will move without any dispersion. So
u, if you assume that x and t both measure in the same unit, then u is dimensionless.
No, so I should go back and say that this equation should have an arbitrary constant here and an arbitrary constant.
Fine.
But you can, because there is an underlying symmetry in this equation, you can redefine variables always and bring it to this form or any other form. There are books where they may actually use a 3 here or something. So you can bring it to any constant, but this is for simplicity, I have just chosen all the coefficients to be 1. That means that all the dimensions are all mixed up. Okay, so let me give you a solution before I tell you how you solve the system. So remember I said a soliton is a traveling solution which is localized, which is non-dispersive, and third, which maintains its shape even after collisions. That's how it was defined. And so let me just give you the solution. I will not tell you how I obtained. So take u, the function u, to be a secant square function, traveling with secant. points were formed. And it is a traveling wave solution because it is a function of x plus vt, v is the speed, okay? And it is localized because it gets wave function beyond a certain distance, just goes to zero. And it maintains its shape. You cannot see here because this is just one wave, but I will talk about that in a minute. And if you take this function and calculate the time derivative, the space derivative, the third space derivative, these are simple hyperbolic functions, and you can use the identities involving them, and you can show that this actually satisfies the KdV equation. Okay, so it's a solution of the KdV equation. And
so the three properties you mentioned, non-dispersive is height is not decreasing.
Non-dispersive means it's not spreading out. It actually maintains its shape.
So the height is also fixed.
Yes.
And localized.
Localized means it doesn't extend to infinity. Yeah? But the third I cannot show you here. For that I have to say something in a minute. So what this solution represents is that it actually has a center. It's just one wave. So this wave is called a one soliton solution. It describes one soliton that Kruskal had defined.
Yes, Chesterov's wave equation has the symmetry that if you go to x2 minus x or t2 minus t, the equation remains same. But here, since we have the first order and third order derivative in x and t, so that is not present.
No, this is unidextrous equations. So the solutions would be either left moving or right moving. It is not an ambidextrous equation. Like d2 dt squared is equal. The space derivative can be anything, but if the time derivative is not second order, t goes to minus t, the direction would change. So the equations which are ambidextrous, they have second order time derivatives. But these kind of equations, KdV equations, is a unidextrous equation. It either allows waves moving to the left or to the right, okay? But that doesn't mean that integrable models, all of them are unidextrous. There are integrable models that have second order and they give you waves moving both ways. Okay, so these are particular characteristics that you shouldn't consider too seriously. Okay, so this is a single soliton solution because it's just one wave, right? You can construct multi-soliton solutions also. I will not go into that, but there are very powerful techniques called backloop transformations. So you can start from single soliton and construct a two soliton solutions. You can sometimes even start from the vacuum solution and construct multi-soliton solutions. So there are these techniques, but that's technical. I will not go into that. You can construct multi-soliton solutions. You can construct a two soliton solutions. And two soliton solutions, if you have, then that immediately allows you to verify what Kruskal and Jabuski found numerically. You can take these two soliton solutions, collide them, and you can ask what happens after they separate, and exactly what they had found in numerical calculations you would actually find. So the solitons are actually very important part of integrable model. Yes.
So in this equation, number of soliton is conserved?
Number of solitons is conserved, yes. So the important part is the solitons, right, in the integrable models. And that has many applications in different branches of physics and medical science and etc. Why? Well, already somebody pointed out about pulses. So let me point out that every time you speak to on your phone, your voice gets digitized into pulses, right? And it is that pulse that is transmitted, and then at the other end, that pulse is regenerated into sound. Okay, so it's a pulse that moves when you are talking through phone. And since the pulse carries all the information, everything that you are saying, it's very important that it doesn't have deformations, that it doesn't get deformed, because then you would lose information. Second, a carrier of conversations, carrier, actually carries not just your pulse, but it carries thousands of other people are talking all the time. And the carrier actually is letting all the pulses go through each other. So if you have pulses that go through each other but get deformed, then by the time it reaches the receiver, the information is all lost, right? So therefore, in telephone conversations itself, already you see how important it is that the shape must be, the shape of the pulse must be conserved, preserved, and then when they go through each other, they should not lose their shape. And that is at the heart of fiber optics communications. Okay, so that's just one example. Medical physics, the functioning of brain is actually modeled with integrable models. Because once again, you think for a moment that suppose you experience some sensation. Somebody slaps you and you feel pain, right? The information has to be transmitted to the brain exactly. If somebody slaps you and you start laughing, then that's going to be a little bit strange, right? Similarly, you eat something sweet and you start crying, right? Then that would be a little bit confusing. So the functioning of the brain is actually modeled with integrable models. And there are many, 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 many examples where solitons are so important.
These two solitons maintaining their shape, it is independent of their velocity, or at certain velocity it breaks down?
At certain
velocity of collision it breaks down, it's maintaining their shape.
No, it's for any velocity.
What I was wondering is that because this equation is an approximation, one is neglecting higher order terms. So at certain velocities, probably higher order terms would be relevant.
What higher order terms?
No, this equation, which is up to third order in derivative.
Yeah.
It will be varied up to certain smoothness.
No, this is the exact equation. The solutions I am talking about are the solutions of that equation.
That's correct. But if I want to look at certain fluid, and this equation as modeling of solitons in there.
So theoretically, you can, if you have a system that is not described by an exactly integrable system equation, well, then you can use this as classical solutions around which you can do perturbations. That you can do, but I am not talking about that. I am talking about exactly integrable systems. Okay? So, solitons. Now, conserved quantities. So here, I want to go back to that. So in the beginning, people didn't know how many conserved quantities were there, and they were calculating by brute force, and three were already immediately known, and there was even a famous physicist who even proved a theorem saying that there can at most be 7 conserved quantities. Well, we will not say who the physicist was, but that was not true. Murat, another very good physicist, mathematical physicist, he, by brute force, just sitting down and doing calculations, he constructed 11 conserved quantities. And so, since the theorem was that there can at the most be 7 conserved quantities, so that actually immediately said that that theorem is not true, something else must be going on. And Kruskal immediately predicted that there must be an infinite number of conserved quantities associated with this system. That we know now. We know that KdV equation or continuous integrable models have an infinite number of conserved quantities. And this is again something that we are not very familiar with. We study systems where there are 3, 4, 5 conserved quantities. But here, these systems have an infinite number of conserved quantities if they are continuum systems. Now, Druskal had an intuitive reason. He didn't calculate, he didn't show. He said there must be an infinite number. And the intuitive reason you can see as follows, that suppose you have a soliton, and then it goes through another soliton. Okay, so just like I was showing, then when it goes through, it collides and goes through, but it comes out with the same shape. So therefore, there must be, so suppose you take a point on the soliton, then that point must resist deformation, right? So that's why it doesn't change its shape. Each point on the soliton resists the deformation of its shape. So that can only happen if there is some constraint there. If something is pushing you that you cannot choose, you cannot change your form. And there is an infinite number of points on the soliton. Each point resists deformation. So there must be at least an infinite number of constraints or conserved quantities. So this was his intuitive argument. And of course, explicitly it can be calculated. In the earlier days, these things, conserved quantities, the infinite number of conserved quantities, used to be calculated by what is known as a Neura transformation. But now there are many powerful ways of constructing these conserved quantities. And I will tell you about one way of calculating this towards the end. By the way, I will make the talk very general towards the very end, but except the last three transparencies or slides may be a little bit technical, not necessarily, it's just classical mechanics. Okay.
So, again, this is more of a confusion for me. So, if there are two solitons coming, different shapes, once they overlap, they are complicated shape.
It's a complicated shape.
We don't know.
Yeah.
Now, is it possible to conceptually distinguish between the two cases that they have gone through, or they bounce back with shape exchange?
No. I mean,
possibly you can distinguish this.
No. 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 I mean, you just look at their centers, right? The center tells you where they are. Look at them when they are. The centers are far distance, and then they separate into two soliton structures. So that you
cannot. And equation is also not ambidextral, so the bouncing back may not be possible.
Bouncing back would not happen, but
bouncing back, the shape has changed.
No. In some other equations, it is ambidextrous. So this is not typical to KdV only. So as I said, there are other ways of also constructing conserved quantities, infinite number of conserved quantities, and I will tell you of one towards the end. Okay, it's a nonlinear equation, and so how do we solve the initial value problem? Suppose I give you the initial data, how do you give me back a unique solution? So that's called the initial value problem, and in this case it's done through a method that I will explain to you in a minute. So let's think for a moment, how do we solve linear equations? This is non-linear, but how do we solve linear differential or partial differential equations? Well, one of the ways we do is we take either the Laplace transformation, Fourier transformation, and we convert the differential equation into an algebraic equation, and then it's easily solved, and then you construct back by the inverse Fourier transform or inverse Laplace transform, right? The Green's functions are always calculated in this way. But here, the Fourier transform doesn't do much because you have non-linearity. So when you Fourier transform, you get convolutions. And so that's not going to help you. And so there must be something else. And again, these four people, Gardner, Green, Kruskal, and Miura, they noticed something very interesting. And they noticed that instead of the nonlinear equation, consider a linear equation. So this is a Sturm-Liouville problem, simply the Schrodinger equation or Sturm-Liouville equation. The operator is linear and the equation is linear. So here they said, well, here instead of a potential, you have a potential depending on a parameter t. Suppose you allow a potential which depends on a parameter t. It can be the coupling constant also, right? It is not, this t is not the time of the Schrodinger equation or the Sturm-Liouville, it's a parameter. So if it is a parameter, then the wave function and the eigenvalue or the spectral parameter will depend on this parameter t in general. But GGKM noticed that if this potential happens to satisfy the KdV equation, well then this spectral parameter becomes independent of t. It becomes isospectral, and the evolution of the wave function with respect to this parameter t becomes very simple. Okay? So this then observed just by analyzing it. They had no idea what's going on, but they realized that you consider this linear equation, and then if this potential happens to be satisfying the KdV equation, then the parameter, spectral parameter becomes isospectral, is independent of t. And the t dependence of the wave function is very simple. Well, then that's very interesting, because then you can study, this is a linear equation, Schrodinger-like equation, Sturm-Liouville equation. You can study the scattering problem for this linear equation. You can calculate the reflection coefficient, transmission coefficient, normalization of the bound states, very easily. So the idea is that study the scattering data for the parameter t is equal to 0. So for t potential ux0, you calculate the scattering data. But the scattering data you can evolve in the parameter t very easily, because this just depends on the asymptotic behavior. But once you have the scattering data at some time t, then you ask, what is the potential that actually would give you those scattering data? And so this entire method is known as inverse scattering. And here you have to use an equation, integral equation called Gelfand, Levitin, and Marchenko equation. And this is how you solve the initial value problem. So let me show. So what I am saying is that you use a potential with parameter t is equal to 0. Then you study the scattering problem of the linear equation, that's very simple, and so you find the scattering data. And then you time evolve the scattering data, because the time evolution asymptotically is very simple. And so you have a time evolved data, and you ask, what must be the potential uxt which would give you that scattering data. So this entire mechanism is known as inverse scattering, and using this, then KdV was solved. And so it was solved using inverse scattering, and that's when you know that the KdV equation is soluble, is integrable, even though it is nonlinear. Okay? So this is a very powerful result, this inverse scattering that was developed, and it says that if you have a nonlinear system which you can solve using the inverse scattering method, then that would be integrable.
So this only probably will require localization of U and things like that.
You should be
probably localized, and that's the only condition that you use. Like
all these equations have localized. That's all. I forgot to say that this Gelfand, Levitt and Marchenko equation. So what happens is that this you may know, many of you may know from your quantum mechanics course, that if U happens to be a soliton solution, suppose secant square like I derived for you, then these potentials, soliton potentials like secant square, they are reflectionless. In that potential, the entire thing just transmits. There is no reflection. So in that case, which is the case with KdV, in that case, the Gelfand, Levitan, Marchenko process becomes just easy. Two lines. Okay? So if you have already localized solutions, like soliton solutions, the inverse scattering is just a minor scale.
So if I want to look for extended solutions, non-localized solutions of KdV equation, this is not a good technique.
No. You can. I mean, what the solutions are always localized of KdV.
Yeah. No. If I'm looking for a non-extended, non-localized solution of KdV, they are localized, but I'm sure there will be also non-localized.
But all of them you can always expand in terms of the complete basis of the KdV equation solutions.
So localized solution forms complete basis.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, because if I am not, in quantum mechanics, BSc quantum mechanics, if you have a finite potential well, so for a particular value of the parameter, the reflectance becomes zero.
So what is it?
So in one-dimensional quantum mechanics, if you have a finite square well, so for a particular value of parameters, it becomes, reflectance becomes zero.
Reflection becomes zero? No.
No,
you have to have very special forms of potential, and the ones that I said are solitons, and one soliton, two soliton, n times n plus 1 over 2 secant square, they will all give rise to zero reflection. They are called reflectionless potentials. Okay, so, I should not explain so much, maybe. Okay, so Lax equation. So these Gardner, Green, Kruskal, and Miura, they observed that if this U satisfies KdV equation, then all these simplifications happen. Lax then formalized their arguments, their result, and he said the following, and this is very general for any integrable system. Is considered a linear operator that depends on a parameter p and has this eigenvalue equation. Okay? So in general, of course, lambda and psi would be a function of the parameter p. And he said that suppose the time evolution of the, not time, but the parameter evolution of the wave function is some linear operator times psi, and then you can easily check that the lambda time dependence, p dependence would be zero, it would be isospectral, if this linear operator satisfy this equation, that dl dt is equal to a commutator of b with l. So this equation is known as the Lax equation, and l and b are known as the Lax pair. Okay? So if you have a Lax pair, which satisfies this equation, then the corresponding eigenvalue equation would be isospectral. And that's immediately very useful, because suppose I take a nonlinear dynamical equation, and if I can write it in this Lax form, then the corresponding linear equation would be isospectral, and I can immediately apply the whole inverse scattering procedure, and I can solve the system. Okay, so he basically gave a formalized way of what you do to have this inverse scattering, what you do to be able to solve a nonlinear equation. And for KdV equation, just for completeness, L is the operator L is the 2 plus 1 sixth U that I told you, and P is del Q plus 1 quarter, it's a symmetric operator, I mean anti-symmetric operator, but this combination is symmetric. Now, in the earlier days of integrable models, finding the Lax pair or Lax operator was kind of a guessing game. and you try something and you keep playing a lot. But now there are very powerful methods using what are known as pseudo-differential operators, and you can actually construct the Lax equation very easily. And in fact, most of the 1 plus 1 systems have been classified using this technique. This is another very interesting property of KdV, is that we know all integrable systems, equations, are actually Hamiltonian systems. They are not necessarily Lagrangian, but they are Hamiltonian systems. And KdV is also a Hamiltonian system. For example, you take the Poisson bracket of two variables to be ddx of delta function. Let me call that a Hamiltonian structure omega 1. Then I gave you the third conserved quantity is u cubed over 3 factorial ux square. I already showed you that. So if you calculate the time evolution of u using this Poisson bracket and the Hamiltonian, well, it's the Poisson bracket of u with the Hamiltonian H3. The Poisson bracket kills out one of the factors of u, because u is something, and inserts the derivative ddx. So if you do that, this term will give you uux, and this will give you u triple x. Okay? So this shows that the KdV equation is a Hamiltonian equation. It's a Hamiltonian system, and the Poisson bracket structure here, or the Hamiltonian structure, is simply ddx of a delta function.
What is that one as a subscript?
For the moment, ignore it, because normally we have just one structure. So therefore, we don't put any subscript, right? But here, there will be two. So just to distinguish them, so I'm saying by Hamiltonian, so there are at least two structures. So just to distinguish between the two, I'm putting one here, I'm putting one here. Is this clear? Because normally, you are used to Poisson brackets of Q with P. Here I don't have a Q with P. Why? Because Q with P, you say when you have a canonical system. But most systems are not canonical. Then you have coordinates on the phase space. You simply label them as Y mu. And then the Poisson bracket is just Y with Y. Okay? So here, U with U. I don't have a Q with P. You cannot separate Q's and P's in general. Only locally you can do so by going to something called a Darboux frame. So Hamiltonian, the KdV is a Hamiltonian. Here is a Poisson bracket Hamiltonian structure. And here is the Hamiltonian, and this shows that the equation can be written as a Hamilton's equation. But actually, this is something new, that it can be written as a Hamiltonian with a second structure also. So example, I take as the Poisson bracket this complicated third order derivative acting on the delta function, so that I call omega 2. That's the 1 and 2, okay? And I choose as the Hamiltonian the second Hamiltonian. Okay? Now, how do you know? This Hamiltonian structure has to satisfy certain conditions. It has to be antisymmetric, when antisymmetry is obvious. And then we'll insert this operator. So the third derivative would give you the linear term. And this complicated term would then give you ux. So this is not something that you are used to. You have difficulty finding only one Hamiltonian structure. Normally you have one, but integrable systems are such that you have more than one Hamiltonian structure. Here, at least in the case of KdV, there are two Hamiltonian structures.
So if one look at this Hamiltonian as quantum mechanical operator, do they commute?
So I will comment at the end. Is that okay? Because quantum is different. Okay. So I showed you that the KdV is Hamiltonian with respect to two Hamiltonian structures. But that's not why one says it's a bi-Hamiltonian system. Bi-Hamiltonian means that you must have two Hamiltonian structures, and a linear superposition of them must also also be Hamiltonian structure. In this case, it's obvious. If I take omega 2, this one, add to it an arbitrary parameter times the first one, well, that becomes the second. That becomes the second structure with a different shifted u. So it automatically satisfies the Jacobian. Why is this important? Well, it's important because the Hamiltonian structures have to satisfy Jacobian identity. Jacobian identity is a non-linear relation. And so it's not guaranteed that a linear superposition would also satisfy. And in fact, if a system is bi-Hamiltonian, then that also means that it is integrable. Well, so let me see. This is the last part, three slides. Do you want to listen to this or do you want me to stop? Complete this one?
Yeah.
Okay. So I told you that this is integrable, and many times I said this equations are integrable, etc., etc. But I never defined what exactly, when do you say a system to be integrable? Right? I kind of cheated. And so that goes back to Liouville. And Liouville said in the 19th century that if you have a dynamical system with a 2n dimensional phase space, then it will be integrable by the method of quadratures. Quadratures means this x and angle variables, etc. If there exists exactly n, half the number of the phase space, exactly n functionally independent conserved charges which are in involution, meaning their Poisson brackets are zero. This is the criterion. What this means, I mean, this is a complicated technical thing, but what it means is that if this happens, you can identify capital N number of quantities that you call the axon variable, and the other capital N variables that are the angle variables, they simply satisfy canonical Poisson brackets, so you can integrate. This is the axon angle variables of Hamilton-Jacobi theory. It's exactly the same. So this is the criteria, that if you want to see whether a system is integrable or not, you have to first find half the number of the phase space conserved quantities that are in involution with one another. If you can do that, then the system is integrable. Of course, finding the solution is another matter, but that tells you that this system is integrable. You may ask, but when you have a continuum model, n is infinite, so how do you distinguish between infinite and another infinite there, right? Well, there is a condition there that if you have a continuum model, then the infinite number of conserved quantities must be doubly degenerate with respect to a complex structure and should be in involution. But those are technical things. Let me concentrate on a finite dimensional model and tell you how the geometry of this works out. So I told you that at least they are bi-Hamiltonian systems. So suppose one of the Hamiltonian structures is little f mu nu, and another one is capital F mu nu. The inverses of contravariant F mu nu I write as covariant F mu nu and covariant capital F mu nu. They are the inverses. They are the symplectic structures. These are the Hamiltonian structures. That's the symplectic structure. Now, because I have two different Hamiltonian structures on this manifold, so they will give rise to the equation, to the Hamiltonian equation. But because I have two different Hamiltonian structures, I now have the possibility to construct another new tensor that has one covariant, one contravariant index. Namely, I take one symplectic structure and another Hamiltonian structure and contract them. This is not possible if you have only one Hamiltonian structure, because then this would be the little f mu lambda and that would give you just identity. But now, when I have at least two, Hamiltonian structures, I have a possibility to define a 1,1 tensor.
Yes, though you are using mu and nu, you only mean configuration variable.
Beg your pardon?
You only mean configuration variable.
Okay.
Though you are using mu and nu in depth in this case, these are just configuration variables.
No, this is the phase space variable.
Yes. But only the relating to the coordinates, not the time.
No. This is
because
the phase.
Because you
this,
think
this
you
is, these are the phase space.
These are phase space.
Okay. So these are time is time is outside of
yeah,
the phase.
Hamiltonian
space. Yeah. So you can have this. So you can ask, how does this structure evolve with time? What's the evolution under a symplectic diffeomorphism? Well, it takes a little bit of algebra, but the result is that you can write down as a commutator of so ds dt is equal to a commutator of s with something u. But this is exactly the form of the Lax equation that I told you. So the Lax equation has a physical meaning in geometry here, is that there is a 1,1 operator, or not operator, a quantity, and its time evolution or symplectic diffeomorphism actually gives you the Lax equation. Well, once you know that this quantity satisfies a commutator time evolution, well, the conserved quantities are obvious. I can define trace of s raised to the power any n, and when I take the time derivative, ds dt would always involve a commutator, trace of a commutator vanishes, and so that would be zero. So the conserved quantities you can immediately construct, but there will be too many, there will be infinite number of them. But you have to select out of them capital N number of functionally independent quantities. Why functionally independent? Well, because H is conserved, H squared is also conserved, H to the N is also conserved. So those are redundant. So conservation follows from the fact that trace of a commutator is zero. Okay? How do I show? So first of all, I have to isolate exactly capital N of them functionally independent. That is normally done by appealing to symmetry that's underlying a system, and with that you can identify n of them if it is an integrable system. But how do you prove that they are in involution? Well, that needs a little bit more mathematics, and that.
One question. So when you were writing ddt, so it so the two t right, one corresponding to h one.
No. It's the same t.
It's the same
t. Remember that it's the same y dot mu. It's at mu nu del nu h1 at mu nu. Because the system is bi-Hamiltonian. Okay? So here, what you do, and this I will not go into, it's a little technical, it's something that I did 20 years ago, or maybe earlier, is you have this 1,1 tensor S mu nu. Now, associated with that, you can define a Nienhuis torsion tensor on that manifold. It's a 1,2, two covariant, one contravariant tensor. And you can show that if this tensor vanishes, then the corresponding Hamiltonians that I constructed, they will all be in involution. So the involution of the conserved charges depends on the fact that the Nienhuis torsion tensor on this manifold is zero. And if that happens, then you can show that the conserved quantities that I constructed here, they actually would be all in involution. And it's a beautiful proof. It simply is the step up, step down relation. And then if that happens, then you can prove that this system is integrable. So the geometry of these integrable models is very special. Okay, it's a manifold, symplectic manifold, bi-Hamiltonian structure, and the Nienhuis torsion tensor on this manifold has to be zero. Well, and there are many more beautiful features associated with these integrable models, but I only could tell you a few, and I hope you benefited from it. as a current on the, so just in a very fast seconds, like here. Mm-hmm. So the right hand side is a current, as you have mentioned that it's a continuity equation kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And so if you set the time derivative to zero, that means the steady state. I mean, just if you set du dt equal to zero, that, so then you have a conserved current. So my question is that the spot, what the Scottish engineer has seen flowing through the river, is it the steady state current?
No. If you have a, so what the Scottish guy saw is this, that it's a moving with time to the one direction, left or right, but with the same shape completely. He saw a solitary wave, single wave, not steady state, but moving completely. Time is not zero there. It's moving for miles, and it is that shape, because the shape simply translates as time goes, right?
What can ask is that, is there a solution there which is a logical solution which is not moving?
No. So I am looking at traveling solutions.
If I look for that, again, continuity can put delu but delu equal to zero. I simply ask if the right hand side is a non trivial solution.
Huh?
Does the right hand side have a non trivial solution for delu but delu equal to zero?
No.
It doesn't have
non trivial. No, it doesn't. We don't know of any integrable models in 3 plus 1. So for arbitrary initial conditions, you cannot solve any 3 plus 1. There are 3 plus 1 models where in a subspace there are integrable structures. It's not there. Yeah.
So you are talking about the water wave.
You have to have a dynamics for the electron. So suppose you have an electron, you have to have a dynamics. First of all, is it nonlinear? Is it integrable? So there are two questions there. Here I am giving you an equation that is nonlinear and that has a solution that moves without changing its shape. Can you find that in an electron? I am saying just now that 3 plus 1 dimensions, we don't have any integrable systems. Not yet, I don't know. And the reason is that finding the lattice operator is extremely difficult, even in 3 dimensions.